let your feelings roll on by. Don't wear fear, or nobody will know you're there. Just lift your head and let your feelings out instead. Now don't be shy, just let your feelings roll on by. On by, on by, on by, on by, on by. Just let your feelings roll on by.
Monday Morning Critic Podcast. Today we are breaking down episode 7 with guest and friend Doug Hutchison. Today's topic is going to be the movie Harold and Maude, came out in 1971. We're going to talk about Doug's meeting and encounter with Ruth Gordon. Doug, how's it going, my friend?
I am blessed, Derek. Life is just amazing. Miracles are transpiring, and I'm happy to be with you again on our seventh. I can't believe you said that, but it's wild that this is our seventh breaking down. So thanks for having me again.
Oh, they're a lot of fun, and you know personally how much I feel about you being a part of the show and these episodes. I love them. So I'm going to break down this movie from my perspective, and whatever I miss, you fill in the holes. Is that fair?
Fair enough.
Okay, so I watched this movie. It's called Harold and Maude, and I liked it very much, and it's trending like crazy on IMDb. I told you that. It's a great movie with some awesome acting, and I'm definitely going to reveal some spoilers here. The guy that plays Harold, Bud Cort, the actor, is obsessed with death. He's reenacting different ways to die. He goes to funerals. You know, he just is obsessed with death. He meets this wonderful person, Maude, who's played by the awesome Ruth Gordon. And she is an older person. She's, I want to say, 80. And she is telling him, you know, you've got the wrong view on life. Not, and I'm summarizing here. You know, your view on life is not accurate. It's, you know, there's more. Life should be lived and life should be enjoyed. And there's another part, I believe, and I hope I have this right, where she has tattoos from what appears to be a concentration camp. And I hope I viewed that correctly.
Yes.
So you know she's been through hell. And for her to say this to him would be a wonderful gesture of kindness and somebody who's most assuredly selfless. So she does this to him. And long story short, I'm skipping a lot of parts here. We fast forward to the end. And the huge twist of the movie, and you guys, if you haven't seen it yet and you want to watch it, I would tune out now. I'll give you 3 seconds. 3, 2, 1. They're about to celebrate her birthday. He clearly is enamored. He's in love with her. She has taken pills to end her life. And when I saw that, Doug, I maybe it was late. Maybe it was, I don't know what it was, but I was so confused. And then you think that Harold is going to take his life and he drives the converted Hurst off a cliff and you think he's dead when he actually is not, you know, he has her banjo. But I guess my biggest problem was, and maybe you can help me here, was a person who, clearly her character, Maude, has seen some shit. And been through some shit, and to aspire this child, or younger man, to live a full life, to live this life, and then end hers, I was confused by it. It doesn't mean I didn't love the movie. I completely love the movie. The Cat Stevens music is...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, God, what a beautiful touch. Right? Oh, it's perfect. Yeah. So, Doug, that's kind of where I'm at. Help me out here.
Well, first of all, you gave a brilliant dissertation of the movie, and it is really interesting that it's a love story, and outside of the box, obviously, because Harold is 18 and Maude is going on 80, and they end up falling in love. What's interesting is Harold is obsessed with death. Maude is obsessed with life. And yes, you're right. At the end, Maude embraces death, and then Harold embraces life. That is the crux of the movie. And I believe what you're talking about being confused, is that Maude, at that point in time, she realizes a few things. One is that she's leaving this planet because her time has come. It's time to go. And she realizes that this isn't the end. And she says to Harold, because he says, when she reveals that she's leaving, he says, "Maude, Maude." And he's so emotional. Mm. And he says, "But you can't. I love you." And what does she say to him? She says, "Harold, that's wonderful. Now go love some more."
Mm.
So her whole concept of love and being in love and sharing love and lifting someone up, she knew Harold needed healing, and she healed him. And so her task, her mission on Earth, if you will, was over. And she understood deep down inside that even though Harold, at the tender age of 18, was, you know, thinking this was this romantic, you know, thing, and they're going to get married and all this stuff, that Maude was showing him a different way to love. And that she knew also deep down inside that there's no way they would get married and, you know, she would potentially die, you know, well before him. And it would be probably far more painful, you know, as they became ensconced with each other. Mm. So as a sort of a sage, as a wise woman, she knew this. But before she goes, she knows that she needs to impart this gift of life to this young man who has had a very rough life and has been, like you mentioned, obsessed with death and darkness. And so she gives him her light before she leaves. And it's symbolically gorgeous. And it's bittersweet, but it's gorgeous. And so it's true love, actually, if you think about it.
No, it is. It is. It's just, know? For me, it was just personally confusing because, like, I kind of, in a way, this movie's 10 times better, but it brought me to another movie, Three Billboards, which won all these Academy Awards. It's not really a good movie. It's very overrated. Francis McDormand's a lunatic.
I didn't see it.
I had a guest before you, Doug, and he was just he brought up some good points, and it's just very overrated. The deaths of key characters are borderline ridiculous. Now I wouldn't say that that her death was ridiculous. It was more confusing for me because I get what you're saying. You know, her purpose had been achieved. But, you know, if she really, I kind of was thinking to myself, if she really loved this boy who clearly is enamored and loves her, she would have stuck around as long as life allowed her to and not kind of taken that decision into her own hands, which
but
I have.
See, I disagree because our perspectives are different. Only because what the caterpillar calls death, the butterfly calls life.
Right. No, I get it.
And so I think that's one of the things she was attempting to impart to Harold when she said, go and love some more. She was like, go, fly. And so she was a selfless. That was a selfless gesture for her to take her life and allow the sparrow in her hands to fly. Otherwise, you know, think about if they would have stayed together and think about relationships and think about, you know, the age disparity and, you know, all of that stuff. I mean, I think she knew this deep down inside, and that's why she needed to fly in her direction, and she needed to liberate Harold in his direction. And again, what she imparts to him is the gift of life, of music, of every day is precious. You are special. You are, you know, when they're in that field of, daisies?
Mm.
And she says, look around you, Harold. You know, what do you see? And he says, well, you know, I see flowers, daisies. And she says, and aren't they beautiful? And he says, well, they kind of all look the same to me. And she says, no, Harold. And she starts going up to every single flower and saying, you see how this one is drooping this down here and then lifting up here, and how this one's has three petals and this one has, we're all Harold, we're all special and different in a unique and extraordinary way.
Mm.
And this is the theme of the movie. And so, unlike you, well, when I saw it the first time, I was floored. Mm. I didn't want her to go like Harold, and I was shocked, but it didn't, in the end, when I was able to absorb the entire movie and maybe even see it again, and reflect on it, I suddenly got the message that, and I think maybe, I don't want to get too, you know, too deep about this, but I think that maybe what the story and what Hal Ashbery, the director, and, you know, what they were trying to impart as well was something larger than life, that and therein lies the difference. What are your beliefs? If you believe that this is it, which many people believe, this is it. This is life, and when you die, you die. And you leave everybody in grief and grieving, and, you know, we go to our funerals and black, you know. That's why when Harold and Maude go to the funerals, she's got a pink parasol, and everybody else has black umbrellas, you know. She's saying death is not an end. This does not mean it's an end. What the caterpillar caterpillar calls death, the butterfly calls life. So she was continually attempting to impart this to Harold in the movie. And I think, I'm just guessing, because I don't know, I wasn't there, but I didn't make the movie. But what I got from it, because I believe, my personal belief, is that death is not an end. It's what we leave behind. It's what we are, it's what we were talking about before we started the podcast, is that that essential imprint that we can potentially leave before we leave. And I think Maude leaves such an imprint on Harold's spirit, heart, and mind, and perspective, that he is suddenly free. He's suddenly liberated. Suddenly, he can play the banjo and skip off into the sunset, despite the bittersweetness of losing the love of his life.
Yeah, and I get where you're coming from for sure, and all your, I get those points, and it's hard to argue, I guess, to a degree. I just, it was, it's just the irony of a kid who has this obsession with death, finally kind of gets over it, and then he's forced to deal with the person he loves and their suicide. I don't know. Maybe,
but how does it end?
You know, it ends the way life ends, you know, hopefully naturally. And I think, this is my opinion, naturally. And yeah, she's going to get older, obviously, but...
No, I mean, how, in the movie, what's the final scene?
I think the final scene is the two of them just enjoying life. I don't think...
No.
That, I mean, that's just my Derek, opinion. That's my Derek, opinion. Yep.
Derek, the final scene... Right before the credits roll,
he drives the car off of the cliff. Then yes. he plays the banjo, and then you turn and see him walk away.
And then what happens?
I don't remember that part. I remember him walking away. Now for me, that was it.
He starts to skip. He starts to dance.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, but I don't know. Don't you think that's a little bit... I don't know.
Derek.
Yes.
It's beautiful. She passed her spirit into and onto Harold. And it will never go away. You know, I had a conversation yesterday with someone who I... had to part with, and I miss very much on a daily basis. And I said to her at one point in time in our conversation, I said, you know what? When I look back on our entire adventure, I cannot help but think about how much fun we had and how much craziness and beauty and laughter. I mean, we had a crazy adventure and it was gorgeous, you know, and I can now that it's over, I don't have to shroud myself in a sheath of grief and depression. I can actually take those moments because, you know what? They live inside of me. Nobody can take them away. They will always be there. And they've affected me. And I will take them to my grave and beyond. And so I'm no longer looking at the end of that relationship grieving over it, as being depressed over it. You know, I'm actually seeing it as a gift. because of what we created together when we were together.
Right, right. And Doug, I get that. Like, it makes complete sense to me. But, like, let me explain it the way I see it another way. So I'm going to pretend that I'm Harold, right? I would be leveled. I mean, I don't think I'd be in love. Anyways, I don't think I'd be in love with an 80-year-old woman, but that's not the point. I think it's somebody you just love, right? It doesn't matter. It's just somebody you have he clearly loves her. And I don't know, I would not be skipping and playing the banjo. I would be just so hurt that my time with this person who has changed my perspective, that has given me this new look on life, that has psychologically been such a benefit for me. And granted, yes, we've had wonderful memories and wonderful moments, and I get that. But my heart would be so hurt that even if I got to spend one more year with her, or 5 more years with her, or 6 more months with her, the fact that she ended her life in a way that I had a tough time dealing with and comprehending death, that she took her life earlier than nature had planned, or divine intervention had planned, I don't know, that would hurt me. That would be very, Doug, I would be angry. I would be angry at that. I would not
he
be.
Was. I get what you're saying. And it's expressed in the movie. Don't you remember that scene where we don't hear the dialogue, but when yes. The doctor comes out?
Yes, yes.
And you're watching Harold's reaction. He's absolutely devastated.
But he goes from that, Doug, to like, and I'm skipping a lot of parts. I get it. But he goes from that. I don't know. I feel like healing would take a lot longer. Healing to me would take a lot longer.
Well, look, maybe you're right. Maybe they attempted to wrap it up too soon. But listen, we don't know how much time transpired between Harold's knowledge of Maude's death and him getting into his car and driving fiercely and intently toward the edge of that cliff. How much time transpired? You're assuming it was continuous. You're assuming that he got the news, he got in his car, and then he started beelining toward the cliff. And then all of a sudden, bam, we think he's committed suicide, and we pan up, but, you know, he just let the car go over, and he's fine. He's got his banjo, and he's skipping off into the distance. Now, that version sounds, like crazy, but we don't know how much time transpired. Because we didn't even get to that Maude's funeral or anything like that.
Mm.
I think what's bothering you potentially, other than the fact that you don't think she should have done that.
I do not. I was because there's a look on his face, Doug, where Harold is like, are you effing kidding me? What? Like, I'm totally there with him at that point. And I got angry at her. I was furious as a moviegoer. Like, how dare she? Like, I don't know. Maybe it's my issue, Doug. I don't know.
Well, I guess you have your perspective. I respect it. It's a very different movie. I mean, it's got a lot of different layers, and I might have to agree with you. The ending perhaps is somewhat abrupt and surprising and shocking, and you have to fill in the blanks. But ultimately, as you take the movie as a whole and you just sit with it, it has so many beautiful messages in it.
Oh, I agree. And oh, I completely agree. The movie to me was absolutely
including her departure.
Well, not for me on that one. We are at disagreement. I'm in full agreement with you up until that. Like, I totally agree. This is a movie that needs to be watched. It's got an 8.0 on IMDb, which means a hell of a lot more people like it than than maybe my critique of it. But
you don't think I have the right to take my own life?
I do not.
Because,
and as somebody, you are, if I'm implying here incorrectly, please tell me, you are a person of faith. Am I wrong or right with that?
You are right.
Right. And going by that context, I don't want to be a hypocrite. Hold on. Let me say. So
okay.
If you're somebody suffering from a disease and every day is hell on earth and, you know, maybe it's cancer, maybe something else is ravishing your body to the point where life just being here is let me put it in a real elementary context. It's the juice isn't worth the squeeze. I guess that could be attributed to psychological well-being as well. However, I am not a religious person. I'm not. But I am a person who, I think I have some faith. I do. I was an altar boy when I was younger. The priests that I had were mentors. They were phenomenal men. I idolized them. I idolized what they did for people.
They didn't try to get you in bed?
No, they did not. They were my role models. And what really, one of the things I still believe is that people do not have that right. That life is certainly precious. That life is a gift. And big picture, I don't believe that people have the right to, you know, think about all these people that are losing their lives on a daily basis, like that wish they had one more day. And for somebody to do that, I believe is selfish. I believe it's, and I struggled with depression, and maybe I still do my whole life, right? And I'm not going to say there's moments where my mind hasn't gone certain places when I was younger. And maybe one day it'll go back to those dark places. But of sound mind, I tell you now, I just don't, in my heart, believe that life is a gift, even in those awful moments. And given your perspective on things, you have a wonderful way of looking at life. My opinion is, I think suicide is not a admirable way out.
But I hear what you're saying, but here's the thing, it depends on what your belief is in when we die. If you believe in an afterlife or not, that's going to change your perspective on life. And I agree with you. In a certain respect, I don't think it's very graceful to leave this world by going into a tub and slashing your wrists and having your family have to find you like that and have to deal with that. However, I was talking to my dad and his new sweetheart, Carolyn, the other evening. Carolyn went through breast cancer, and she survived, blessedly, and is a survivor. And I said, I might blow your minds here, I don't know, but I said, you know what I would do if I had cancer? No chemotherapy, no trying to hold on to the thread of life and being fearful and trying. You know, I respect people who want to do that, it's a personal journey. I said, but if I had that, you know what I would do? I would get my dog, Dortney, and I would get into my Jeep And I would take my cell phone and I would record myself journeying around the country with my cancer as I die slowly and gradually and go through all of those transitions. And I would go and say goodbye to every person in my family. They're all over the place. Pennsylvania, down south, Carolina, Washington, LA, everywhere. And I would also meet people along the way, you know, who are also struggling with their struggles and record them and our conversations. And I would record the whole thing all the way up until my death. And you know what? It'd make one hell of a documentary.
Yeah, it would. Yeah.
So I'm not afraid of death, and neither am I. I'm bracing myself for the death of a loved one. I have not had to really hold that yet completely. I lost my grandparents, yes. I was very close to my grandfather. That was the closest I've come. But still, I have not lost. I still have my dad. I still have my mom. I've never lost a spouse, my brother, you know, somebody like that. So I have yet to hold that, and I'm bracing myself for that. But I think, I don't know. I agree with you that suicide is generally a very selfish way to go. But in this movie, because of the theme and the texture and the message, I believe that Maude's suicide is not gruesome and it's not malicious. And it's not leaving Harold with as much pain as it is infusing him with light and life. In the context of this film.
Yeah, I get that. And you have, your point is so well made. And by the way, if you ever did do that, you would leave behind so many hurt people that care for you, Doug. Like, I get the beauty in it. I see it. But I also see the tragedy in it. You know, if it's a cancer that you could beat, if it's a cancer that, you know, you have a shot at, you know, beating, you'd leave so many people hurt. I don't know. That's
Derek, you are making the assumption that death is a tragedy. That's the assumption that's the diving board you're diving off of, the assumptive diving board. Okay? Mm-hmm. Do you know there are cultures around the world, and I know it's hard for our Western minds to wrap ourselves around this, but I saw a documentary a long time ago. I don't know. I think it was Borneo or something. Some primitive tribe. And when their people died, they didn't wear black and get somber and cry and grieve and, you know, all that stuff. They wore colors. They painted their faces. They danced in the streets as they held the tarp with the body on the tarp of their relative, their friend, their loved one. They danced in the streets and they celebrated their life. And it was a party. And then they put them on the pyre, on the pier, and they burned the body, and they danced around the flames in a celebration of life. Why? Because they don't believe that it's the end. They're actually rejoicing that this person is now going to be in the arms of the Great One. And they actually showed, and I know this is going to sound really macabre because for us, but they showed a scene where there was a cave, and it was full of bones and skulls and the remains of what couldn't have been burned in the ceremony. And there were children from the tribes playing on these hills of bones and skulls, and picking up the skulls and smiling and saying and showing them to the camera. Like it could have been one of their uncles or something, you know?
Right.
And they're like, yay, yay, yay. It's like, it's all perspective. Our lives and our deaths are all perspective. And that's what I'm trying to say about this movie, is that it's about the perspective. If your perspective, Derek, is that death is nothing but tragedy, then I understand why you would have such a visceral reaction to Maude's leave-taking. But if your perspective is that death is not an end, and that life, it's about life being rejoiced and revered, then your perspective changes.
And I get where you're coming from. You know, I think you and I will always disagree on this, but I think we agree on the fact that it's a great movie. I think that's something that's not up for debate, but I'm dying to hear, speaking of life, how Ruth Gordon affected your life in a positive way.
Oh boy. Where do I begin? I saw Harold and Maude came out in 71?
71.
I'm dating myself here, but I was, 11 years old when the movie came out. So I guess I probably saw it, not when it came out, but maybe a few years later, 15, 16 years old. I don't remember. But I just, for some reason, I don't know why, I was just enamored with Ruth Gordon and her spirit and her character in the movie. And I became absolutely obsessed with her, like Harold. She became my favorite actress. She was, and at that point in time, she was indeed, getting up in her years. And I ended up watching all of her movies. She did all of those Every Which Way But Loose movies with Clint Eastwood and the monkey. And, but she has a rich history in theater. She came to New York when she was 18. She went to the Actors Academy. She was booted out of the Academy, told she couldn't act a lick. Couldn't act her way out of a paper bag, she was never an ingenue. She was always this quirky little character actress, and the thing is, she never gave up. Never, ever, ever gave up. No matter how many doors were slammed in her face, no matter how many no's were thrown at her, no matter how many you're never going to make it were given to her, She just kept believing and having faith and moving forward. And maybe that's part of why I was enamored with her as well, because not just seeing her in these movies, but I ended up reading her autobiography called An Open Book by Ruth Gordon. And in it, she tells a lot of stories about, you know, how she was rejected and how she maintained and kept moving forward and keeping the faith. And she had three favorite phrases in the book: never give up, keep the faith, and don't face facts. Those were her three mantras in the book. And as a young, now we're talking like I'm moving into my early 20s, right? And I'm like, you know, actually considering this acting thing as a possibility. And I've got Ruth Gordon in my heart and in my mind, and she just affected me not only in her movies, but in her book. And I don't know, it was just weird. I can't even explain the ethereal connection I seem to have with this person. I just knew that I was enamored. That's all at that point in time. So fast forward, 1984, I'm 24 years old. I'm accepted at the Juilliard School in New York. I'm thrilled. I moved to New York and start attending school. Juilliard is up on like 66th Street and Broadway, Columbus area on the Upper West Side. I was living at the West Side YMCA across the street in a little box of a dorm room, if you could call it that, because Juilliard at that point in time didn't have a dormitory to offer to their students. I believe they do now, but at that point in time they put their students up at the West Side Y. We're sharing, like, you know, our living spaces with like homeless people and crazy people, and you know, there was like a public shower. You didn't have your own shower, you know, you had to go into the public shower with all these wackos. It was very colorful. And then right around the corner, I got a job at a little bakery called the Country Epicure. And, you know, we made croissants and cookies and different things like that. And so that was my little triumvirate. You know, that was my space for my first foray into Juilliard. It was school across the street, home, West Y, and then right around the corner on the weekends, I would work at the Country Epicure. Well, I'm in New York. I know that Ruth Gordon lives somewhere in New York. And this voice inside of me is not leaving me alone. Every night, as I go to sleep, as I wake up in the morning, as I shower, I hear this voice saying, you have to meet Ruth Gordon, you know, obviously before she dies. And at this point in time, she was, I think, about 80 years old, you know, like she is, you know, approaching in the movie in Harold and Maude. So I set out on an adventure. And I decided I am going to meet Ruth Gordon. And I was keeping a journal at the time, and I still have it. And I wrote that in the journal. I am going to meet Ruth Gordon. What I did was I took her book, and I ended up highlighting little clues in the book about where she might be living in New York. Now, now I'm a true stalker, right? So she would say things like, I can see the beautiful expanse of Central Park outside of my living room window. Okay. I realize she lives somewhere on the periphery of Central Park. But where? Central Park South, North, East, West? I didn't know. But you look further into the book. When I look out my bathroom window, I can see a little patch of Broadway. And I look down on the street and see the colorful silhouettes of people walking by. Oh, so, and walking by toward Times Square, I think she says in the book. Oh, that means she must be on Central Park South. If she can see a patch of Broadway out of her bathroom window. When I look out my kitchen window and look up, I can see the top of the Moni sign blinking its time and temperature. Well, there it is. There's the Moni sign right there, right around the corner on 58th Street and Broadway. So now I'm zeroing in. Yes, indeed, she must live on Central Park South between Broadway and Fifth Avenue. So she says also one of her favorite bakeries is this bakery shop around the corner on Fifth Avenue, I believe, and 59th Street. And she mentions the name, and I go and suss it out, and there it is. So I decided I've zeroed in on where Ruth Gordon lives. Now, in the meantime, I'm going to school, right? Mm. And Juilliard is, it's very demanding. I mean, you don't have a lot of time. You are there Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. And again, I was working at this bakery on the weekend, so I didn't have a hell of a lot of free time. But I'm starting to impart this dream of mine to meet Ruth Gordon to my classmates in class. And they hear it. They're hearing it constantly. And they're getting kind of irritated by it. It's like, all right, duh. All right, so you want to meet Ruth Gordon. We know. You know, we hope you meet her someday. Okay, let's move on. And then all of a sudden, all of this quirky stuff started to happen. Like, Juilliard used to give us, when they could, they used to get complimentary tickets to Broadway shows. And they'd give them to their students to go see the shows, because we didn't have the money to go, you know, see them on our own. And there was a show, and I got tickets for the show. And that weekend, I got really sick with a bad cold, and I ended up giving my tickets to somebody else. And the next Monday morning in class, her name was Gayla, one of my fellow students that I had given the tickets to. Gayla comes up to me in movement class, and she says, thanks so much for giving me your tickets. I really enjoyed the show. She said, you'll never guess who was sitting in front of me. Right in front of me. Ruth Gordon. I was like, no. You're pulling my leg. She said, no, I swear, Doug, it was Ruth Gordon. And all of these people in my class were having encounters with seeing Ruth Gordon somewhere. I saw Ruth Gordon the other day at the such and such produce store. And I'm like, what the hell? So I decided one afternoon that I was going to, now that I figured out where I think she may live. Now, mind you, all of the buildings on Central Park South between Broadway and Fifth Avenue are high rises, condos. And there may be five or six of them all in all. And I went to my dorm. I wrote a letter to Ruth, and I just poured my heart out to her. And I just said, I just love you. You've inspired me. I'm a student at Juilliard. I have aspirations to be an actor. You've given me nothing but inspiration with how you, you know, just never gave up, and I'm never going to give up, and all this stuff. And I wrote this letter, and I decided I'm going to get this letter to her somehow, some way. So one afternoon, after my shift at the Country Epicure, I went to Central Park South, and I go up to the first high rise, and they all have doormen, right? Security guys. And I go up to the first doorman and I say, excuse me, can you tell me, does Ruth Gordon live here? And he said, no, no. And I said, oh, okay. So I go up to the second high rise, go up to that doorman. I ask the same question. Excuse me, do you happen to know if Ruth Gordon lives here? He's like, Ruth who? Going up to the third high rise, and then all of a sudden I'm thinking, Doug, are you nuts? Like, even if she does live in one of these buildings, is the doorman going to tell you? And then I remembered one of the quotes in her book, and she said, when you have a dream or a mission, go for it. Don't face the facts. Move forward. Go for it. So the fact was that the doormen probably weren't going to tell me if she lived there, right?
Right.
But Ruth's telling me in her book and in my heart, don't face the facts. So I didn't. So I go up to the third building and the third doorman, and I asked, does Ruth Gordon live here? And he looks directly into my eyes, and he says, as a matter of fact, she does, young man.
Wow.
And then I took it a step further, and I said, I'm trying to get this letter to her. Could you tell me what apartment or condo she lives in? And he says, 3D. And I said, could you possibly give this letter to her when she comes in or goes out? And he says, I would be happy to. And I walked away, and I went back to my dorm, my YMCA room, my little cell block, YMCA. And I wrote her another facsimile of, now, mind you, this is pre-email, folks. This is all handwritten stuff at this point in time, like handwritten letters. So I write another letter, and I mail it. Just in case I'm thinking the doorman doesn't hand it to her, I mail it to that address. Now I've got her address. I've got her condo number. I've got her. I know where she lives. And I would mail her a letter every week. I would slip it in the mailbox. And then on top of that, as if I'm not a stalker enough, after my shifts at the Country Epicure on Saturday and Sundays, I would go and sit on the bench in Central Park, facing Central Park South, right across the street from Ruth Gordon's condo, hoping, praying to catch a glimpse of her coming in or out. And I never did. So we fast forward now to we're talking at this point in time. I started school in September. So this all started in September and bled into October and into November. And now we fast forward to the weekend of Thanksgiving, 1984. Everybody's left town to go to their families for Thanksgiving, and I decide to stay in New York and work at the Country Epicure while we're on hiatus at school. And I'll never forget this. It was a Sunday. I woke up out of bed, and I had this feeling inside, like I bopped out of bed, and I was filled with energy and life and vigor, and I took my shower, talking to the homeless guy next to me. We're brushing our teeth, and you know, and I get dressed and I go to work. I go to the Country Epicure. And I have two other employees there, two other cats, these two other young men who are working with me. And we're making our, you know, croissants and chocolate chip cookies. And it's a very, very slow day because it's a holiday weekend. And we're bored and we're standing around. And we just started to play a fantasy game. And it was, if you had one wish in your life that could actually happen now, like today, not like, you know, I want to make $1 million or I want to be a famous actor or anything like that, but that could happen actually today, what would that be? And of course, what comes out of my mouth, I want to meet Ruth Gordon. And these guys have, like my classmates, have heard it like ad nauseum. And they're like, ah, right. Yes. Okay. What do you want, Joe? And we went around the horn. Now, Derek, here's the part nobody's going to believe, but is I'm telling the God's honest truth. I kid you not, about 45 minutes later, if that, the window of Country Epicure it's steamed up with condensation because it's one of those crisp, clear New York cobalt blue sky days. It's cold. You can see your breath when you breathe. It's just it's an invigorating kind of November day. And the temperature's making the window frost up. And so when you look outside, all you can see are like these colorful blurs of silhouettes of people walking by. And about 45 minutes after that popped out of my mouth, I want to meet Ruth Gordon. This little fist comes up to the window and rubs off the condensation, a little circle of condensation, to look in at the goods that we have displayed in front of the window. And then a little face comes up into that circle, the clear circle that was rubbed off, that was clear, that rubbed off of the condensation from the fist. And it's Ruth Gordon.
Wow.
And her little wrinkled, beautiful face and sparkling eyes looking down at the goods in the window, on the window ledge. And I stood there for a moment that seemed like eternity. And I said, hey. I felt like I was in a dream or something. And I said, hey, guys, that's Ruth Gordon. And they looked and they went, holy shit. It is. It is Ruth Gordon. And I just stood there in absolute awe. And they're like, go. What are you going to do? And I said, I don't know. What should I do? And they said, go, give her a chocolate chip cookie. And we just had these warm chocolate chip cookies that had come out of the oven. They were like pie shaped, you know, they're the big giant chocolate chip cookies. Right. And they said, go give it to her. Go. So I walked out, and it, as if in a dream, I'm standing there before Ruth Gordon with this big giant chocolate chip cookie in my hands. And next to her is her husband, Garson Kanin. Now, Garson Kanin, back in the day, was a very profound and respected playwright, author, director. He and Ruth Gordon were really close to like Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn and all of those old school movie stars, and that was their circle. And there was this other woman with them by the name of Mary. And I just stood there, and I'll be honest, I don't know exactly what I said. I babbled, and I just said, probably Ruth Gordon, I'm such a fan, and I this and that. And then I mentioned Juilliard, and I'm just going on and on. And at one point she goes, oh, she said, Gar, this is the kid I've been getting all these letters from. She said, you've sent me like 100 letters. And I said, I know. I said, you know, you've just inspired. I don't know what I said. But she said, I'm so sorry. She said, I've been meaning to respond, but I've been in Los Angeles. I've been shooting this movie. It was actually her last movie that she shot. She said, but thank you so much. And I gave her the chocolate chip cookie, and she thanked me for that. And they walked away, and I just floated back into the country epicure and felt that I had manifested a dream. So Monday morning rolls around after Thanksgiving Day weekend, and I'm in move-in class, and I'm like, hey, guys, I met Ruth Gordon on the street, literally, like, she, and they're like, oh, God, finally, thank God, we don't need to hear about it anymore. Well, I believe it was maybe 2 or 3 days later. Now, mind you, this is I'm dating myself. This is pre-cell phone. We do not have phones in our little cells at the West Side Y. The only phone access we have is a pay phone down in the lobby. And we receive messages from the counter at the West Side Y if we've got somebody who called for us or what have you, or if we have mail. And I walked into the Y after school one day, and I had a mess. I went to the counter, and she handed me a little pink slip with a message on it. I opened it up, and it said, call the Kanin Agency. And there was a number on it. So I went to the phone booth. I put a quarter in it or whatever it was at that time. And I called the number, And this woman answers. She says, Canaan Agency? And I said, yeah, hi, this is Doug Hutchison. I got a message to call. And she said, oh, yeah, hi, Doug. She said, this is Mary. I met you when you came out of that bakery and you met Ruth and Gar, remember? And I said, oh, yeah, hi. And she said, I'm so glad you called. She said, Garson wanted me to get in touch with you because he just wrote his latest play called Time and Chance. And there's a character in the play, the principal character, the lead character, a little 16-year-old boy by the name of Charlie Holden. And he's an orphan. And he is adopted by a very wealthy woman. Kind of a Pygmalion sort of story. And Garson was very taken with you and would like you to come in and audition for the role. And I said, oh, okay. And she said, so could you come over here and pick up a script and read it and we'll set up an audition? And I said, okay. And she gave me the address to the office and I went to the office and she handed me the script. And I walked home with it. I went to my favorite Korean market to get a salad and take it up to my room and eat and read the script. And I read it, and it was a role to die for. This kid, this orphan kid, this foul-mouthed orphan, urban little hood of a kid gets adopted by this millionaires. And then it's about how he has to adjust to his life in this new, whole new world. And it was really beautiful story, and I couldn't believe it. And so the next evening, I'm walking with the script in hand from school back to the Y, and before I head down 66th Street to the Y, I hear this voice behind me say, Doug. I turn around. There is Ruth Gordon, Garson Kanan, and Mary, that woman Mary, standing on the corner crossing the street in the other direction. And Garson sees his script in my hand, and he says, good, you got the script. We're going to see you, what, next Thursday? And I said, yeah. And he said, great. And they walked across the street. So the audition rolls around. My heart is pounding in my chest. I go to the audition, and it's just Garson Kanan and me. And it was the most, now in retrospect, because I really wasn't used to auditioning a lot up until that point. Now in retrospect, it was the most effortless audition that I have ever experienced. Garson, all he did was he had Mary read with me, and all he did was lay back on his couch and he closed his eyes to listen. And we went through a couple scenes, and I recall as I was auditioning, I recall the phone was ringing off the hook in the background. I was aware of it, and some receptionist was picking it up and taking the calls. And I didn't know until well later on, but that was Ruth Gordon calling, saying, did Doug come in yet for the audition? How did it go? Is it a go? Is he good? Is it gonna work? So I left the audition, and I believe it was the next day I got another message, call the Canaan Agency, and I called, and I got Mary, and she puts me on with Kanan. And he says, Doug, I want you for this role. You're perfect. You were born to play this role, Charlie Hoban. And I was just floored. Now, here's the caveat. Juilliard frowns upon their students leaving to go do anything. Plays, movies, TVs, no. Juilliard is a 4-year program, and they want you there all 4 years. And their whole formula there is that in the first 2 years, they break you down, and in the last 2 years, they build you up into the Juilliard image. They're the Juilliard student, the graduate. And they eliminate many students after the second year. They accept about 24 in the first year. And then after the second year, they cut about half. And if you're one of the lucky ones, you're one of the lucky 12, you get to stay for the third and fourth year. That's how the program works. And they do not want their students going out there and working until they are well-schooled at Juilliard. That's one of their rules. Well, there was a teacher there by the name of Marion Seldes, and she was an old school Broadway actress and just happened to be very, very tight with Garson and Ruth. She was actually one of their best friends. And Marion went to the headmaster, I guess you'd call him. I don't know what the term is, but his name was Latham, John Latham. And he's very, very stoic, British man who never ever cracked a smile. And when you walked by him in the halls, man, it was intimidating. He would look at you with his eyes and he would never talk to you, just nod. And one afternoon at school, I was called up to Latham's office. And he had me sit down, and he looked at me, and he said, Douglas, I understand from Marion Seldes that you're desiring to leave Juilliard in order to go do a play. I want to know why I should even consider that as an option. So I sat there shaking in my boots, but I told him the entire story in a nutshell, the Ruth Gordon story. My obsession, how I met him, how I met her, how I met Garson, how I got the audition. And by the time I ended the story, I saw a little tiny, slight, imperceptive smile crack on the side of this guy's face. I'd never seen him smile before. And then all of a sudden it was gone. And he gained his composure again. And he said, well, Douglas, that's quite a story. I'm going to take it to the staff. We will decide and we will give you our decision as soon as we decide. And I said, okay, thank you. And I walked out. Well, I'll be damned. About 2 days later, I get called back to his office and he says, we've decided, Douglas, to allow you we're going to make an exception to allow you to go do this under the circumstances. We don't do this generally speaking, but we're going to release you to go do the play, and then we will invite you back for the second year of Juilliard, of your program here at Juilliard. So, goodbye, good luck, see you next year. So, I was released from Juilliard to go do Time and Chance. Now, the strategy was to play it at a regional theater in the Midwest, and then take it to Boston, I believe, or maybe Baltimore, maybe, I'm not sure, in the hopes of taking it to Broadway, ultimately. That was the strategy. Well, they premiere the play at the Cricket Theater in Minneapolis, Minnesota, where I was living, where I moved from to go to New York. I lived in Minneapolis for 5.5 years. So it was just like another one of these, I'd like to say it was serendipity, but I'm now wondering if it wasn't fate. So I go to Minneapolis, my hometown now, basically, even though I grew up in Detroit, I considered it my hometown for quite a while. I did a bunch of theater there. And I am doing this play in Minneapolis. Well, it was a big deal at the Cricket Theater. The Cricket Theater was like a B-Lord theater. It wasn't one of the huge theaters there, but it was a really relevant theater in Minneapolis. I get my equity card. So now I am a working actor. Now, I'm not getting paid much. I think I got paid like $300 a week or something. But still, I'm a working actor. I'm a union actor. And I'm a lead in this play premiering in Minneapolis. And the Garson was flying out to rehearse with us and do rewrites and whatnot. And while we were rehearsing, we would have conversations, and he kept saying to me, or asking me, what are you doing at Juilliard? Why are you at Juilliard? What are you doing at Juilliard? And quite frankly, I was not happy at Juilliard when I was there. I felt suffocated there. I felt confined. It didn't feel good to me to be there. I wasn't looking forward to it every day. There are no windows in the school. There's no light coming in. And Juilliard, with all due respect, because it is really one of the most prestigious schools in not only in the United States, but in the world. And I was privileged to have been accepted there. It teaches from the outside in. It's a technical school. It's very classical. Shakespeare, movement, voice, diction. And really, at that point in time, at my age and where I was at, I wanted something more inside out. And I wasn't getting it. So here's Garson saying, what are you doing there? And I'm like, what do you mean, what am I doing there? This is like one of the best drama conservatories in the country, in the world. He said, Doug, you're a diamond in the rough. He said, yes, you can get polished at Juilliard if you so choose, but you don't need it. He said, Spencer Tracy used to tell me, there are only two things you need to know as an actor. One, your lines, and two, how not to bump into the furniture on the set. That's it. He said, so your best education is going to be experience. You don't need school. He kept pounding this into me over and over and over again. So fast forward, Garson Kanin unfortunately suffers a stroke during our rehearsal period, and therefore he's unavailable now to come out and do any more rewrites. And we end up premiering the play as is. And we went up to tepid reviews. They were lukewarm. You know, they weren't bad, but they weren't great. I somehow came out smelling like a rose. Like, I got some decent accolades out of it, but the play itself as a whole just did, it wasn't cohesive enough to move forward. So it lived and died in Minneapolis at the Cricket Theater. However, Garson Kanin, because he, you know, had was in recovery from his stroke, and Ruth Gordon came to the premiere. And so it was this big, huge to-do in Minneapolis. I mean, it was huge. It was on the front page of the news. It was big news. You know, this was a huge deal. Garson Kanin, Ruth Gordon come to see Time and Chance at the Cricket Theater. And it was just, it was a glorious adventure. Now we fast forward, and I'm back in New York, and I'm walking across Broadway and Columbus on my way to Juilliard to sign up for my second year. And I crossed Broadway, and I'm standing on the little island between Columbus and Juilliard, and I'm looking up at the building. And there's those golden embossed letters on the brick of the building, the Juilliard School. And Derek, I don't know why this happened, but I just sat down on the bench. There was a bench there on that island between the streets. And I looked up at those letters, and I just started sobbing. In the middle of Manhattan, I'm sitting there like a fool, a child, sobbing. And I'm thinking, why am I crying? And I knew why I was crying, because I knew I wasn't going back. I knew it in my heart. But I also knew that in that decision, it scared the shit out of me. Because I didn't know what I was going to do if I didn't go back. But I listened. I listened to the voice. And I knew the repercussions. My dad flipped out. What? Are you crazy? My friends, my family, my former high school drama teacher, all of them flipped out. Are you nuts? You're quitting school at Juilliard? What's the matter with you? I don't know. I don't know what's the matter with me. And I started working jobs, a lot of crazy jobs, delivering pizzas, working as a waiter down on Wall Street, and messenger, and all this stuff just to pay the rent, because I was no longer staying at the Y anymore, because I wasn't at Juilliard anymore. I was now down on West 47th between 9th and 10th. In Hell's Kitchen, in a little roach-infested flat, living with my girlfriend. and no direction really, just working and trying to figure it out. And eventually I got on the phone, or I got my Rolodex out, and I looked up Garson Kanin's number, and I called him, and I got him on the phone, and I said, "Hey, Garson, it's Doug Hutchison." And he goes, "Hey, how's it going?" And I said, "Well, I took your advice. I quit school. Now what?" And he said, "Well, do you have an agent?" And I said, "No." And he said, "Well, we got to get you an agent, kid. Let me make a few phone calls." I said, "All right, thank you." So he calls, and he sets me up with a meeting with David Gus, the president of the Gersh Agency, huge agency, not only in New York, but L.A. based as well. And I go in and I meet David Gus, and we sit down and talk. Now, mind you, I have absolutely no experience outside of doing Time and Chance and my little community theater endeavors in Minneapolis. Other than that, I'm just a Juilliard dropout. And David Gus, in the meeting, he says, "Well, I got a high recommendation about you from Garson Kanin, but tell me why I should represent you, a dropout who has absolutely no experience. You don't have your SAG card. You've never done TV or film. Why should I represent you?" I knew he was testing me. And I said, I thought about it, and then I looked him dead in the eyes, and I said, "Because I'm going to be a huge star, and I'm going to make you a lot of money."
Hmm.
And he smiled like the devil, like from ear to ear. He had this huge, impish grin on his face. And he said, "I like you. I'm going to represent you. I'm giving you a shot." So I got my agent. And shortly thereafter, well, no, not shortly, I should say maybe 2 years after, I got my first movie, Fresh Horses, and got my SAG card, became union. I would say about a year to date after the premiere of Time and Chance, Ruth Gordon died. God rest her. And my encounter with her changed my entire life. It transformed my entire life. From getting cast as the lead in this amazing play to making the decision to quit school, to getting my first agent, to getting my equity card, to getting my SAG card, ultimately, it set me on my way and opened the door to the manifestation of my career and my dream and my life. And therefore, I as you know, I teach now, and I attempt to impart to my students, never, ever, ever, ever dismiss that voice inside of you. Whether it's a yes or whether it's a no, that voice will never steer you wrong. You just have to get still enough and trust enough and have faith enough. And as Ruth Gordon says in her book, don't give up, keep the faith, and don't face facts. And you will manifest your dreams. And that's my Ruth Gordon story.
Wow. Wow. What a powerful story. That went so many places I never thought it was going to go. I thought it was going to be a chance encounter, a conversation. And wow, she's legitimately affected where you are now. That's amazing. That is absolutely amazing.
She like in Harold and Maude, as she left an imprint on Harold, she left an imprint on me in a big, big way.
Yeah, and I see why the movie means a lot more. Yeah, I definitely see it now. Yeah. Doug, is there anything
just
you want?
Just a sidebar. Yeah. I had the pleasure of having a scene with Bud Cort in the second movie I ever made in 1988 called The Chocolate War.
Mm.
And he was playing one of the teachers in this all-boys school, and I was one of the students. And we have this hilarious scene where we're playing a prank on him. And so anyway, I got to meet him, and we talked about Ruth and fondly, and he shared stories about Harold and Maude, and I shared my story with him. And so that was kind of a really cool sidebar encounter as well.
Yeah, man, I love that story, and I love today's podcast. We will be back with next week. It'll be Breaking Down 8. Doug, are there any final thoughts you had?
No, just, follow your heart, follow your dreams, follow the voice. Again, I wish everyone, follow your bliss, and you will see miracles transpire.
Doug, thank you.
Thank you, Derek. I had a once again, I had a blast.
Well, if you want to sing out, sing out. And if you want to be free, be free. Cause there's a million things to be, you know that there are. And if you want to live high, live high. And if you want to live low, cause there's a million ways to go, you know that there are. You can do what you want. The opportunity's on. And if you find a new way, you can do it today. You can make it all true. And you can make it undo. You see. It's easy. You only need to know. Well, if you want to say yes, say yes. And if you want to say no, say no. Cause there's a million ways to go, you know that there are. And if you want to be me, be me. And if you want to be you, be you. Cause there's a million things to do, you know that there are. You can do what you want. The opportunity's on. And if you find a new way, you can do it today. You can make it all true. And you can make it undo. You see. It's easy. You only know. Well, if you want to sing out, sing out. And if you want to be free, be free. Cause there's a million things to be, you know that there are.